This is the Distance Learning Anarchy series on podcasting. This episode is how to podcast, gear choice and general tips on gear, setting up your room, editing, and just getting a good back and forth between you and your co-host.
Dedicated to those who think they have great audio.
Hi, I'm Michael Dean from the Freedom Fiends Radio Show. You should probably listen to me because I've done a few thousand great sounding podcast episodes. I've been podcasting constantly since 2006. My show Freedom Fiends sounds great even though it's done live and my co-hosts and I are in different geographic locations. Our show was the first podcast to ever evolve into a syndicated terrestrial radio show. We're on a few dozen commercial talk stations around America and we're listened to around the world on streaming and MP3. I want to show you how to do all this so when I'm too old and stupid and cranky to speak into a microphone, other people in Liberty can pick up the torch and do it. I'm going to show you how to do everything I know about podcasting, from making a great sounding podcast with remote hosts over a $50 microphone and using the free software Audacity, all the way up through the equipment you should get if you have an unlimited budget and unlimited free time to mess around with gear whoring. There are a bunch of sections in this video. The first part is Davi Barker and I talking over Skype the way we actually do a show and giving lots of cool tips and tricks. Then there's going to be the unboxing and setup of this inexpensive microphone that I recommend. Then there are some software tutorials and a bunch of other nifty stuff, including some redemption in the third act. So hang out, have a vape of something fun, tipple a tasty beverage, and enjoy. And if you don't like it, make your own damn podcasting tutorial. I'm talking to Davi Barker, who is one of the Freedom Fiends co-hosts. He's on the other end of the inner tubes. Hello, Davi. Are you safe?
I am safe. I have not been contacted by the government.
Excellent. Excellent. Now, are you doing the same things you'd normally do when we do a show?
You mean as far as the mic and the headphones and everything? Yeah, this should sound the same.
Okay. Talk a little bit. I'm going to get a sound level here. I'm going to turn you down a little bit on my end.
Hey, this is me and I'm talking.
Yeah. Excellent.
Nothing in particular.
Excellent. Yeah. That was a really good show last night, man. I dug it.
Yeah, that was fun.
Thank you for your service. And I'm going to put a little compression on you. Hang on a sec.
Go ahead and talk.
I'm going to redo what I'm working on.
Okay, what are you working on?
I am working on Survivor Max.
Tell me about Survivor Max. Oh, don't. We'll save it for a show. It's not going to go in here, and I know about it. So
okay.
So you talk about Survivor Max, and then I will cough, but mute it with the slider on my end to show how that works. So go ahead. What's Survivor Max, Davi?
Well, currently, Ellie and Stinky and Max are raiding Judge Burke's house. Burke is a sort of nasty dude in New Hampshire, although in this story, he's sort of succumbed to infection. And so his home is open for homesteading. And so they're going to find it. And I don't want to spoil where they find it because it's sort of nasty. But that's what I'm working on right now.
Well, cool. I stepped away for a sec to show you on the Skype. Now, people should note that we are not using Skype video. We turn off the video when we do Skype because it takes away from the tubes of
bandwidth issue.
And you notice that Skype kind of, when we both talk at the same time, it kind of cuts the other person out. The Freedom Fiends programmer and IT guy, Derek Slopey, is working on Fiend Phone, which will solve that problem and replace Skype. So if that comes out by the time you actually see this video, if you see it late, substitute the word Fiend Phone for Skype and go to feenphone.com. Trying to think what other tips I can give. Cooling and heating your room before the show so you don't have fans going. Don't have your roommates using Netflix or downloading torrents or anything that's hardware and, you know, bandwidth intensive. You can have them, you know, they can be surfing the web, but they shouldn't be watching videos. They shouldn't be doing anything that uses your pipe.
Feed your cat. Make sure he has water.
Ah, why is that?
Because they might come and ask for it.
That is a good point. Like, basically, preparing for a show, it doesn't take a lot of work, and it takes less mental work as you do it more and more over a period of time. However, it's kind of like preparing to meditate or pray. You have to or drop acid. You kind of have to have a special prepared, set and setting to make it good, I would say.
Some sort of a do not disturb sign is not a bad idea. I put an on-air sign on my front door, so when my wife comes home, she knows.
Yeah, some of our co-hosts, since we are on radio and can't cuss, do put up a don't cuss sign to remind them not to cuss. We do have a cuss dump, but it's we'd rather not use it. It's a 7-second delay, but yeah. And the you know, it's kind of funny. You can get these like light up radio station signs that say on air, and they're like burnished steel, and they're like $200. And I have seen so many podcasters that like buy one of those and still have crappy sound. Like they spend the money on the light to impress their roommate or spouse or basically themselves, but don't even bother like, you know, spending the $50 on a better USB microphone like you have. So you don't have a mute, huh? You don't have a, do you have a
Skype mute? Has a mute. I could use that.
Yeah. Go ahead and use it so we can hear it in practice.
Sure. Just a second. Let me pull it up here real quick. I usually, when we're doing the Fiends, I have other windows and things that I'm reading from. I don't generally have the Skype thing as the primary window.
Yeah.
Let's see. It's probably this button right here. Does this sound cutting in and out? Can't really understand what I'm saying.
Okay. Yes. And it's very abrupt. Where is that in the window?
There's a little sort of blue window that Skype puts on the front, even if you're in another application, and there's a picture of who you're talking to. There's a picture of a microphone, which is the mute button if you click on it, and there's a picture of a red telephone, which is the hang up button if you click on it.
Yeah. Hey, let's turn on video for a minute. I'll point the camera at the Skype so people can see your mic and your setup. You're using a $50 mic and a, what, $30 scissor mount and a 50-cent pop filter.
So this is the mic here. You can see set up. I have in kind of a shock. What do you call it? A shock mount.
Yeah.
And then I've got, this is the scissor arm thing here.
Yeah.
That wraps around. I don't have the greatest camera, but that's not terribly important when you're doing radio.
If you stop moving it, it'd be great. All right. There you go. All right.
So this is the mic here.
Yeah.
You can see, this is headphone jack here. This is the computer connection here, and that goes into the back of the tower. So it's just a USB mic, goes right into the USB drive in the back of my PC.
Okay, now let's turn off the video so we can hear you better, so you get better quality.
So I was off mic. I was across the room. I'm on mic now. So how much did you spend on that setup?
Oh, I don't remember. It couldn't have been more than $50. Probably not even more than 20.
Well, I think I gave you the mic, right?
Yeah.
So the mic was 50 or 52 with shipping or something, and the scissor mount was 30, I think.
That sounds right. And that came with the bracket for the desk and the shock mount. Headphones cost about $5.99 at whatever liquor store you happen to be walking past.
Yeah, I use the scissor mount, but I'm showing a close up of it here. I use a like it has a clamp that goes on a table, and it's a table that is not the table I'm touching. It's not the table in front of me. It's a table to the side of me.
I used a couple of those foam windscreens above and below it, so when it clamps into the table, it dampens it a little bit.
Yeah, mine has a little patch of cardboard around it.
So what advice would you have for doing a live radio show over Skype where we're not in the same room and we can't see each other, for having a good back and forth and not cutting each other off, but not sounding, I don't like to use the word retarded, but you know, Skype has a little bit of a latency between one person to the other, and added to the amount of time it takes to think or politely wait for a person to stop talking, it can make you sound pretty stupid. Like, let's do it. Okay, so what do you think?
Like if we're just talking over each other, you mean? Is that what you're talking about?
Well, it's kind of intuitively, what I'm going for is intuitively finding the right mix between not cutting each other off too much, but not sounding really stupid, like you have to wait 5 seconds and say, over. Yeah, we do it really well, I think.
It's sort of intuitive, I guess. I mean, I guess it's just being polite to each other.
It's being polite, but excited, I think is what it is. Yeah, and we do talk over each other a tiny little bit at the end of sentences sometimes, but... And you're a lot better at it. When you first started doing interviews in Skype, you were like, I don't know, I guess.
Yep, I've come a long way, baby.
You have. Do you have any other tips for aspiring podcasters or radio people?
Yeah, I guess for me, it was about going from being a writer to being a speaker. And the thing is that speakers produce a lot more content, so it's a lot easier to sort of consider everything a rough draft and sort of correct as you go. Yeah. Whereas a writer, you might sort of take your time and want to say it right the first time and blah, blah, blah. And you have a lot more time and material, so don't be afraid to kind of just cut loose and talk.
One thing I think especially with Liberty Podcasting, there's a lot of people who are doing the same thing. Like, they're basically opening up the newspaper and commenting on it would be like the old radio version of it. But now it's like opening up your Twitter feed and looking at like, oh my God, look what Obama did to us today. And look what Cheney is still doing to us. And look what the police did to this guy in San Antonio. And it's kind of like, I think that stuff's important to have out there, but there's so much of it right now. I don't even know that there needs to be another one of those. I think that there's an available market for people doing just kind of general interest liberty podcasting, kind of like what if the government were already had already drowned itself in the bathtub, like what would be the general interest talk show of the day?
Yeah, I think the other problem, or this is a quality problem that Liberty Media has right now, is that there are enough of us that we can find each other's personalities abrasive, which means that there is a niche for your personality out there, right? Like, even if you're saying the same things that everybody else is saying, there might be an audience out there that likes you more than they like me, right?
Yeah, there's at least three, you know, of the like 40 or so Liberty podcasters that there are doing it regularly, there are three of them I can't stand. And, you know, you and I have done scathing appraisals of two of them. And I did a scathing appraisal with Nima of one of them a couple years ago. And so there's room for all. It's kind of like rock music. Like, why start a new rock band? Well, because, you know, there's a lot of great rock bands out there, but there might not be the one that somebody would want to listen to yet, and you have to go make it. And it's the same thing with talk spoken media.
There's also room in every other niche pop culture interest. Like, if you look at a lot of mainstream podcasts that are not necessarily libertarian, their quality is terrible.
Yeah.
So if you can sort of decide that you are the Ninja Turtles podcaster, or you're the Game of Thrones podcaster, and you come in with like not only good audio, but also like a sort of like libertarian interpretation of all of these things, like you're reaching a larger audience, and you're going to steal. You're not going to steal, but you're going to win the market share from those other pop culture podcasts that are kind of amateur because they're about enthusiasm.
Absolutely. So I guess that a couple other tips we'd have technical stuff was you had a problem with your mic that was really strange, which was that there was a hum. Yeah.
There was a count for voodoo.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, basically troubleshooting is kind of like okay, if you're troubleshooting a system like a mic, a computer, a recording device, software, et cetera, like, you replace one thing in the chain, and if you still have the problem, it's something else in the chain. So what we finally figured out was it was not hum in your room. It was not hum in your computer. It wasn't in your electric. It was something with like...
It was the North Pole.
It was. Basically, your mic hummed when it was facing east and west, but not north or south, right?
No, when it was facing north and south, opposite. But not east or west.
Yeah, and it took us weeks to figure out what that was, man, because sometimes you'd have it, sometimes you wouldn't. It was intermittent even when you had it. And finally, I said, all right, you know, take the mic, have your room be completely quiet. I'll mute my mic and listen to you over Skype, and you just point it in different directions in the room. I was looking for the source of a fan or something that was humming, or a fluorescent light.
And we found some things that way. Like the lights in my room were causing a little bit of a buzz, and some part of the screen was causing a little bit of a buzz, but it wasn't the whole of it.
Yeah. And I guess another tip I would have is make sure your computer is wired, not wireless, when doing something with a remote host. You get a better connection and a stronger Skype signal and better audio if you're wired rather than wireless. And you got to use headphones. You know, you can't do a show well using speakers to monitor on. You need to save the file about every 30 minutes or so the computer, the program doesn't crash or the device doesn't crash. Brick houses are good. If you're buying a house and you want to make it, if you want to make your life making media, brick houses are a lot more soundproof. Soundproofing is different than sound conditioning. Sound conditioning is deadening reverberation in the room. It's really easy. You just hang up blankets or rugs. Soundproofing, like keeping inside sounds in and especially keeping outside sounds out, is a lot harder. And brick houses do it a lot better than wooden houses. Brick houses with triple ply windows are the best. So if you're buying a house, I would say look for that. Yeah, brick houses are also pretty bulletproof too, which could save your life.
Yeah.
If things get bad.
Oh, yeah. If you're on the road, you're better off in a closed car than in an open parking lot. And you're better off in a closed hotel room than in an open hallway.
Absolutely. Yeah. Think about background noise. You know, if you're, I mean, a car is basically a mobile recording studio. If you go in a car with the engine shut off, it's one of the best places you can record. They're soundproofed and sound conditioned. Have your RSS feed on your site, not through Feedburner or some third party, because you want complete control of it. You don't know if they'll go out of business and you'll have to tell everyone to resubscribe. You don't want to have to do that. I would say ignore dancing baloney on your website. You don't want goofy flash interfaces. You don't want autoplay, right, Davi?
No, I will boycott your website if sound comes out without me asking for it.
Yeah, basically we feel that like that kind of stuff, autoplay, is like a social contract. It's like you've come to our website, so you've agreed to our conditions. So you don't want that. I would say release everything Creative Commons so anybody can reuse it without permission, and we have that in the banner at the top of the Freedom Fiends website now, that anybody can do anything with it. I would say a SoundCloud page is not a podcast. You want your own domain and your own RSS feed. You know, a collection of audio is not a podcast. You want to be able to subscribe to it once, never come back to the website, and get it automatically in your pod. I recommend having different computers for different things if you can, so you're not overburdening everything on one computer, which can cause glitches and dropouts in a recording. You can get cheap computers on eBay, or just when you upgrade, keep the old one, you know, to use just as your Skype computer or something like that.
Don't take calls.
Don't take calls. People are horrible.
Prep your callers before you put them on the air.
Oh, that's another thing too, is do a pregame if you interview anybody. Like, don't just say, yeah, we're going to interview you at 10 o'clock on Sunday. First of all, determine what time zone they're in, say 10 o'clock Eastern or whatever, so they don't get confused. I've had that problem. And second of all, try to do a 5 or 10 minute pregame with somebody before you do an interview with them, because it allows you to get a rapport with them, figure out if their sound is horrible, give them tips like, hey, you know, put your kids and your dog and your cat in a closet or something so they don't interrupt the show. Or things like, you know, I guess I can hear that you're using speakers, not headphones. Do you have headphones, even earbuds that you can plug in? Can you get closer to the mic? Can you get further from the mic? And some people get really snippy about that. They're like, I'm important and everything that comes out of my mouth is great, even if it sounds horrible. But I usually explain to them, like, I'm doing this for the ages. I want this listened to in 100 years. And the better it sounds, the more likely it's going to be able to be listened to in 100 years.
Yeah, them being important is why you do that.
Yeah, yeah. And people who don't get that, I generally don't want to interview. Thank you for your service. Your sound sounds pretty good. I hear a little bit of background noise, but I think that's something on the street. Is it construction or something?
My computer fan's pretty loud right now. I didn't restart it last night.
Yeah, that's another thing, is don't leave computers on for weeks at a time unless they're in the other room operating as torrent servers.
Reset your machine altogether before you start, because that'll make sure the least amount of things are going to collapse.
Yeah, and also I would say make sure you do that anyway and start Skype 10 or 20 minutes before you do a show or an interview, because Skype loves to auto-update and not give you a choice, and sometimes it requires a reboot, and you don't want to be doing that when you've got some rock star, you know, guy who's only going to give you one chance, or girl, it's a lady, it's only going to give you one chance to interview him. Don't promote your podcast at all until you've got your first episode up. Because really what you want to do is basically do a sound test, upload it, test your RSS feed, then do like a chat with a friend that you might not even use just to test doing a podcast with someone. Do a short one, 5 or 10 minutes, work on putting in your intros and outros. Oh, also don't use music that is popular and copyrighted. I would say use Creative Commons covered music. Read the licenses, PodSafe music, you can surf that. A lot of people say, well, I don't believe in intellectual property, so I'll use anything. I don't believe in intellectual property, but I believe it can bite me in the butt and they can just seize my website. So I don't use copyrighted stuff. There's a lot of people, you know, everyone's got a friend in a band or that makes music. Have someone make music for you and let you use it for free. I've seen this mistake where people get an idea for a podcast and then, like, they haven't even done a test and they're promoting the website to their friends. Don't do that. You want to work out all the bugs in private and then do a good good first episode with somebody. Doesn't have to be anyone famous. Just, you know, it could be you reading something you wrote. It could be best is you with a friend. Here's the thing is, like, it's a lot easier to do a show with two people than one people. It's very rare that someone can carry a whole show by themselves. And the people that do, they usually actually have a second host. It's the voices in their head. It's the hamster in their brain.
Yeah. This is also how people get hooked on episodic media now, is they binge on like 10 episodes and then they're disappointed when they come to the end. And that's what keeps them coming back the next week.
There you go. That's true of TV and Netflix TV and, you know, downloaded media and podcasts.
So that's what you want to do. Your user's first experience should be like, that was really cool. I'm going to listen to all of it. And then they're going to run out. And that's what you want.
Yeah, like a friend of mine did his promoted his cast before he released one, and then had an interview set up with a libertarian rock star. Total, like, everyone knows the guy's name. And the first episode didn't sound very good, and people went to it and, like, they were like, okay. And he, you know, he should have done, you know, taken all my advice and done a first good episode with, like, a nobody like you and me. Then got the sound good and then gone for the rock star interview. That's what I think.
There you go.
All right, Davi, any closing remarks to today's up and coming youngsters who want to make great Liberty Media like you and I do?
Thank you for your service.
I got one more. Don't try to make money at it. Don't quit your day job. Don't think you're going to make money at this. We're syndicated on 26 radio stations right now and do 6 shows a week. And the show's been going for 3.5 years and started as a podcast. And we barely cover expenses with it. We could hustle it more, but then we'd have to make decisions that would violate our integrity, or at least, like, we'd have to make decisions that wouldn't be. It's more fun if it's a hobby, is what I'm saying. And you can do better, more hard-hitting stuff if you don't have to worry about what advertisers think.
You know what I do, and this doesn't really apply to the fiends, but it may apply to you, is learn your garbage schedule. Yeah, if you're going to be doing interviews with people in a sort of different schedule than the one that I have, which happens to be a different schedule, but, like, if I'm going to be on Freedom's Phoenix or I'm going to be on whatever and somebody wants to do an interview with me, I won't pick a time that coincides with my garbage pickup, because you can totally hear it.
Well, actually, I live in a brick house and you cannot hear the garbage pickup from my room in the back. I'm in the back of the house, garbage pickup's in the front of the house. And it's a brick house, man. I'm telling you, you know, buy that $50 microphone. And then when you're going to spend $200,000 on a house, make sure it's brick.
There you go.
And live in a place like Wyoming that doesn't have a lot of people driving by listening to hip hop. And pick a street that's not a through street. So only the people who live on your street are likely to drive down it. So you don't have a lot of traffic.
I mean, I guess the most important thing is have fun. Because if you're not having fun, the audience isn't either.
I guess that's where we could end, is the old Spinal Tap thing of, have a good time all the time.
And be excellent to each other.
Worms.
Worms.
Thanks, Davi. So, this is an Audio Technica 2005. It is the centerpiece of the Michael Dean Easy $50, well, $70, podcasting and take over the world with media libertarian journalism school technique. So I just got this. The mailman just came. I'm really happy. I'm going to do an unboxing. This mic's great. You should get one. All right. So put it down here. Get a big old knife. Cut the little tape. It's on here. Don't cut yourself. Open it up. All right, unboxing. I've never done one of these. I think they're pretty stupid. But actually, in this case, it's not just showing off bling. It's showing what to do with it. Okay, instructions. Don't throw them away, but put them to the side. This is your little travel carry case that you can put your mic in when you flee the country to Prague or Croatia or Albuquerque. No, Acapulco, to get away from America. All right, this is the mic. It's pretty cool. It's got an on-off switch. That's on. That's off. So put it on. This is an XLR cable. If you don't have a mixer, you're going to save this until someday you have a mixer. This is the mic you should get if you don't have a mixer and you're just doing USB right into your computer. This is the mic clip. It's a little bit bigger than most mic clips because this mic's a little bit bigger. So set the mic aside. The mic and the clip and the USB cable. You want to undo the little bread tie on here. Throw the bread tie away. All right. And there's that. So save the box. It's a pretty neat box if you ever need to send this to somebody. Or okay, this little thing is a little table microphone stand. This goes on here. This goes in here. And then the mic goes here. But you don't want to use that. That's too far away from your face. And it's going to pick up you tapping on the table or anything you're doing. So take the mic out of there. Don't put it on here even. I'm just showing you what not to do. I wouldn't throw this away. It's kind of neat. You could use it for a camera or something, but set it aside. So what you need is a mic stand like this. These are about 12 bucks on Amazon. You can show it from top to bottom there. All right. So this mic stand, you're going to bring it up like this. You're going to lock this down like this. All right. Let's see. Righty tighty, lefty loosey. All right. This has a clip on it that I put on it. These generally come without a clip. This one is too small for this mic, so I'm just let it fall on the floor and put on the one that comes with the mic. Put it on tight. Don't break it. Put it on tight enough. Doesn't have to be. There we go. Then you turn this around if you want. You can loosen this to move this. Everything on here can be changed and adjusted. All right, so the back of this mic, it's kind of neat. This has a little USB plug in here. This goes in, like that. And then your headphone output goes into this. This gives you latency-free monitoring, and then that's a volume. Volume only controls your headphone volume, not the volume of the mic. Okay, when you get this mic, you're going to put the windscreen on it. You're going to plug the small end of the USB into the little port on the back of it, little USB port, shaped like a trapezoid. If it doesn't fit, flip it around. Then you take the other end and plug it into any USB port on your computer. You'll hear a little ding-dong. It'll install the drivers. Light will come on immediately, but it won't work unless this switch is toward the tip. If it's down like this, the beautiful blue light will still be on, but the mic won't pick up any audio. You have to have this on. I just leave it on all the time and mute with a mixer or with the mute button in Skype. All right, so you're gonna put this on this mic stand there. So I'm gonna put this here and have it right here. See, you want this mic right in front of your face. You don't want it down here on the table. You're gonna get better sound, less background noise, if you have it right up here. All right, you're also gonna need a windscreen, one of these little poppy things. Put that on the mic. There, that's your $70 perfect podcasting kit right there. All right, you do need headphones. They don't have to be great. You can even use earbuds, just anything that won't leak. Like, you don't wanna use the old Walkman style open ear headphones, because they'll leak sound from here into here. So put your headphones on, go to the back of the mic, plug into there. You're not going to do anything with this. This is the XLR output if you were using a mixer. This mic is dual purpose. So you have the mic right here near your face. And then you take the USB and plug it into the computer. Okay. You can see that there's a little blue light that comes on here. And you should get some kind of your computer auto-installing drivers. If it doesn't do that automatically, you can look at your manual. It tells you how to do it for Windows, Mac, and Linux. You may have to go into your Windows properties in Control Panel, Sound, and pick your speaker. And it'll say AT2005 USB. That's the mic acting as a speaker because your headphones are plugged into it. That's the one that's on right now. It's got the little green dot there. Then you can go into recording, microphone, same thing, set it. If it's not correct, if it's showing something else, you could go into properties and set it as the default playback device.
right there, but I'm not going to change that because as long as it's working. Well, let's see. Let's go ahead and record some here. All right, so I'm opening up SoundForge. And you see the blue light on it, powered by the USB, means it's on. And you hit the iron button in your recording program, talk la 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 la. Some programs you can monitor it while you're doing, some you cannot. All right. That's a good overall volume. You don't want anything bigger than that. And you don't want anything smaller than that. Generally, in the middle third, like not all the way to the top and bottom on each channel. Let's take a mono track here. You know, let me record again. Okay. Check, 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 check. La, 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 la. Testing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. All right. There you go. That's a good level. Good, strong level overall.
Check, check. La, 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 la. Testing. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Yep. And then, you know, if you normalize that, it's going to look really solid.
All right, here are some general recording tips for setting up a studio, getting a good sound in the room. I've put rugs on the walls, held up with little nails. They're cheap rugs from Walmart. You can use carpet remnants if that's all you have, or if you want it to look good, you can use carpets, or you can just hang up blankets around the room, as I showed earlier. Got a long rug in the corner behind the microphone. There's one here, 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 here. Thick curtains that I close sometimes if the neighbors are being noisy. Another one. All right. Got some more. Hardwood floors, but we got some cheap area rugs. Got those at Walmart too. Don't have to cover every single surface, but I cover, you know, all the little things. All right. As I said, brick houses are better. Triple ply windows are better. Turn off your fan when you're recording. Cool your room before you record. Before your show, turn off your fan and your heater and the air conditioner. Cool or heat the room as needed before the show and during breaks if you need to, and turn that stuff off. This is slowing down to a halt. All right, there, I stopped it. You don't want anything that's going to make background noise. You don't want a humming computer. You want to have your mics away from the fans. Computer choice. Desktops give you more power for the money than laptops. But if you have laptops, that's okay. Just keep the mic away from the fan. Operating system. I have a Linux machine, but I never use it. I don't know much about Macs. The best Windows operating system for editing audio and the best Windows operating system in general is Windows 7. Don't get Windows 8. You might have to look around for one with Windows 7, but as of Windows 8 being the latest version, I would pick Windows 7 every time. Equipment. First thing is you want a dynamic mic. You want it on some kind of mic stand. So it's right in front of your face, a couple inches away. If it's on the table far away, it's not going to be good. It's going to pick up a lot of external room noise and tap in the table. That scissor stand was $90, but you can get them for about $30. I'll list that in the notes with all the other equipment. Or you can get one of these really cheapo, just kind of standard ones like this for about $12 on Amazon or at Guitar Center. Although the Guitar Center, they're really pushy. You should get it on Amazon. You don't want it touching the table. You don't want the mic stand on the table. It's going to bump the table. It's going to pick up things from the table. You want a mic stand on the floor. I do not recommend condenser mics. This is a very expensive condenser mic that would not be good for doing radio. It would pick up too much background noise. It would pick up the rustling of your shirt when you scratch yourself. Any dynamic mic is better. This is a $500 RE20. It's the broadcast standard. It's good if you don't have any mic technique, but if you have mic technique, which we're going to cover, this is a $130 Shure Beta 57A. It's a Shure Beta 57A, actually with an SM58 frame basket at the end, and then covered with a windscreen. This $15 microphone with a mixer would sound better than this $250 condenser mic. You don't want to use condenser mics. You want to use dynamic mics. Do not use those horrible Yeti mics. They look fancy, but they're really bad. If you don't have money for a mixer, get the Audio-Technica AT2005 USB mic. It does not require a mixer. That mic actually works really well through a mixer, though. If you do have a mixer, it's a good mic. It works really well non-USB through an XLR cable into a mixer. I'm using the Audio-Technica that way right now through the mixer to record this. So when you get your Audio-Technica 2005 USB mic and set it up on a stand so it's in front of your face and put a windscreen on it. There's the windscreen. All right, on the back of the mic, there's three things you need to know about. One is the USB input goes in right here. You know, the one end goes in your computer, the other end goes into the mic. It's a special USB cable. Then your headphones plug into the back of the mic right here. That gives you latency-free monitoring. And then there's a volume knob that only controls the volume going to your headphones. It does not control the recording volume of the microphone. It's only for the headphones, and that's right here. So plug those in, put the headphones on, and experiment with them. Get a good sound. You may have to change your, you know, Windows or whatever your system is, you know, control panel, sounds, options for the device. It'll show up as both headphones and speaker. You may have to change it there. You may have to change the levels in your recording program. You may have to change them in Skype. But I'm going to show you how to do that later on. All right, there you go. Let's get into recording. Any good dynamic mic will work as well as the RE20. The RE20 is expensive. It is the broadcast standard. It's in pretty much every radio studio in the world. But it's for people who don't have any mic technique. They don't know to move back when they get loud. They don't know to get up close when they get quiet. They move their head back and forth a lot. They kind of forget the mic's there. They don't go off mic to take a breath like I've showed you doing before, which is a good thing to do. If you have a little mic technique, you don't need an RE20. You can use pretty much any other dynamic mic with a windscreen on it. All right, electricity. First thing you should do is buy a ground tester. They're about $7. You plug them into a 3-prong outlet. The lights on them will tell you whether or not the ground is good, bad, or dangerous, or fatal. You use the little legend on the back of it to see what the ground's situation is. If your grounds are wrong, they can kill you at worst, but at best, they will give you bad sound and add noise and hum to your recordings. And if you do not have 3-prong plugs in your house, you don't have grounds, and you shouldn't be plugging anything in, it can kill you. Don't ever use one of these 3-prong to 2-prong ground lifters. You'll get noise at best and die at worst. If you have bad grounds and you own the house, hire an electrician to come fix it. I spent about $150 having a guy come spend a couple hours. And I followed him around with the ground tester, making sure he had corrected each one. And if you don't own your house, tell your landlord your grounds are dangerous and they could be fatal. That's a good word to use with landlords. Any landlord that doesn't promptly address an issue that could be fatal, you've got problems. But most landlords will address an issue if you kindly and correctly put it that way. Okay, liquids and electronics do not mix. One spill can destroy a piece of equipment. It can also electrocute you. Keep liquids away from electronics. If you have to have liquids around, get a spill-proof sippy cup. I will link a good one in the show notes. I actually travel with one of these ground testers. If I'm doing a remote radio show from somewhere, sometimes the grounds on one side of a room will be bad. If they are, I'll use the ones on the other side of the room or even run a 3-prong electrical cord to get to a good outlet. And I always inform my host wherever I'm staying or performing or doing a show from if the grounds are bad, then at least they can get it fixed later for next time you come back or just to make the world a safer place. Why try to rely on the state for crap like this? Just let people know and a lot of times they'll get it fixed if you explain the importance to them. Okay, second thing is I would recommend getting a power conditioner. Power conditioner gets rid of noise that is present in all electrical lines. Also, this one has a readout, nifty readout, so you can actually see the fluctuations of voltage that various areas have. I also recommend a surge protector. Here's some surge protectors. I also have an uninterrupted power supply, which also has surge protectors built in. This will power my whole show, including the modem connecting to the network, for about a half hour. If the electricity goes off for a while, usually doesn't go off for more than that in my town. If it does, it's out for a day, and I'm not doing a radio show anyway or a podcast. They don't make this power conditioner anymore, but Furman still makes good power conditioners. I will link a comparable model in the show notes. All of my things are plugged into things that are plugged into this power conditioner. It filters the power in the whole room. So I use multiple computers for multiple things. That way you have less memory-intensive things happening on one computer. If you spread it out over a few computers, even over used computers, you're less likely to have something crash, a program or computer crash during a show or a recording be lost on a computer if you're recording on a computer. Okay, recording a show over Skype or, you know, in the same room with two people, mainly over Skype because that's what I do. I'm trying to teach how to do that. There's three ways I'm going to show how to do it, from easiest and least expensive or no money to medium way to do it to most expensive and best way to do it. The easiest way to do it is to record on one computer using a Skype utility, recording utility. You can do that on one computer. Recording Skype on the same computer on Audacity is extraordinarily difficult to do correctly. I don't recommend it. You need to use a third-party recording utility for Skype. Second hardest way is using two computers recording from Skype, having Skype on one computer and recording onto the free program Audacity on the second computer. That's a little better, but you have to have two computers. The way I do it, which is the best way to do it, is to record it to a Zoom H2 or a similar SD card recorder using a mixer and using Skype on one computer, going to a mixer, and recording to an SD card recorder. Okay, but first we got to set up Skype for the mic, and that's going to be the same for all three recording techniques. So I'll show you that first. Okay, there's a few ways to record a remote Skype call for a podcast. I'm going to show you the easiest, what I think is the easiest, and the most no-brainer, and the one you can do on one computer. First of all, you should set your Skype options volume. Go to Tools, Options, Audio Settings. You need to pick your input and output device from the drop-down menu in Skype. Here's the input. Here's the output. This mic will come up as the speaker also. AT is Audio-Technica, AT2005 USB. Speaker is obviously headphones in this case. You're plugging your headphone into the back of this mic. You may also have to pick the correct input and output device in Windows or whatever your operating system is, and also in your editing program if you have problems recording or hearing what you're doing. A really common problem with microphones is you set them up, but you don't enable them as the correct input sound device in your computer, and you think you're using the mic, but you're not. You're using, you know, the laptop's mic or your webcam's mic, which is the default. And there's a really easy way to test. Basically, you just tickle the mic. If it sounds like this, the mic's working. If it sounds like this, it's getting picked up by some other mic. You can also check it by, also rubbing on the laptop. And if you get a loud sound rubbing on the laptop in your headphones, you're probably using the laptop mic. You can do the same thing with the webcam mic. If the mic is working and you touch it very lightly, it's going to be loud and clear. All right, there you go. And these will normally be clicked. Adjust automatically microphone settings, adjust automatically speaker settings. Unclick those and turn them both all the way up. This one, yeah, there you go. Turn these all the way up. Sometimes that'll undo itself after a Skype update, but keep an eye on it. You want to not have it automatically adjust it. You want to be able to do it on your end or in post-production. And save the settings. All right, some terms. Inputs are anything that you're using to put sound into your system, whether it's going into the computer or into a mixer first. You know, another Skype computer, a microphone, an iPod, anything that's putting something into your signal chain is an input. And a mixer is a device to put these inputs together and set them up with matching levels. You want the levels of everything matching as closely as possible. I mark the channel for each input with a label maker. And make sure you use the shortest cables possible. You know, don't use a 50-foot cable when you can use a 5-foot cable. Don't use a 6-foot cable when you can use a 3-foot cable. The shortest possible to get the job done, because adding length adds noise to the signal. With all these techniques, the editing is pretty much the same no matter what. It's just the recording that's different. Okay, method one, recording Skype on one computer using a third-party utility. Now, you want to install this program. The way I'd like to do it generally is like record, you know, have a dedicated computer for Skype, doing nothing else on it, have it going into a mixer, be able to adjust the level of the other person versus me. I'm into the mixer, the other Skype computer's into another channel, and then have the output going from the speaker headphone jack with a Y splitter, which I'll show you later, going to some kind of SD card recorder like a Zoom H2 or anything in the Zoom series. But I'm going to show you how to do it without buying extra equipment. So all you have is the mic, headphones, mic stand, and windscreens. Download this program. I'll link this. It's called MP3 Skype Recorder. There's also another utility called Pamela for Skype. I'll link that below, but that costs $20-some. And the MP3 Recorder program is free. There's a couple podcast friends of mine do that you can check out to hear something recorded this way. My friend Mike does the Non-Aggression Podcast. That's NAPODCAST.com. He records with the MP3 recorder. And my friend Nick records the Anarcho-Yakitalism Podcast at AN-YAK.com using Pamela for Skype. Download the latest version. Okay, so I'm going to get this. Save it. It's downloading. All right. So I'm going to install this. Run. Safe. Okay. I accept the horrible terms I haven't read of every piece of software. Okay. Install. All right. It's complete. Finish. Delete the install. Grab the thing. Comes on. All right. I want to go to options. Let's see. 16-bit. Those aren't good. All right. Sample rate, 44.1. Bit rate, 128. Mode, I would say mono for recording two voices mixed together. I don't like to record them as separate tracks. You just get it right the first time, and you don't have to do it. All right, and it's going to... Oh, that's a hard one to find. All right, I'm gonna put it in my C drive, just for the hell of it. Okay, C, computer, there. I'm going to just put it into that, into the C drive. All right, on. Call sound test.
Hello, welcome to Skype call testing service. After the beep, please record a message. Afterwards, your message will be played back to you.
Hello, you weird British robot lady. This is Mr. Michael Dean, broadcasting live and worldwide from a windowless bunker. La 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 la.
Hello, you weird British robot lady. This is Mr. Michael Dean, broadcasting live and worldwide from a windowless bunker. La 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 la.
Okay, that worked. Off. Let's open up the folder it's in. Yeah, it's in the C drive. C drive. Easy to find. Easy to find. All right. There it is.
After the beep, please record a message. Afterwards, your message will be played back to you.
Hello, you weird British robot lady. This is Mr. Michael Dean. Bye.
All right, that worked. I'm going to save this file and then call Davi. Answer your Skype. There we go. Davi.
Hello.
Hey, Davi Barker. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Good. I'm doing a little Skype test here, like as if we're doing a podcast. So what's up with tyranny? Is there any tyranny today?
No, tyranny's been driven into remission. We're finished. The mission is over. Victory!
Yay! Libertarian paradise, or lib-pair.
Yeah, sure.
All right, thanks, brother man. Worms.
No problem. Worms.
Bye. All right. Let's listen to that. What's up with tyranny? Is there any tyranny today?
No, tyranny's been driven into remission. The mission is over, and
got to work on the sound levels there, but yeah, that's pretty good. That worked. Okay, that's recording an editable file directly on your hard drive using a free recorder for Skype. You should always tell people if you're recording them. I don't think it's ethical to record anybody who doesn't know it. Although governments aren't really people, but check your laws. Okay, method two, recording Skype that's on one computer on another computer using the free program Audacity. All right, I'm going to show you how to record into Audacity from another computer. You plug your audio output from one computer into this computer and then do this. Set your input device. Yes. So in Audacity, you got to set the input devices. And I'm going to do it wrong here, and then I'm going to show you how to do it right. Okay, got that one. Now, wait, where's the other one? Got input, where's output, where's input? Okay, there's nothing there. It's blank. This is a problem. Comes up sometimes. It's if you set the sound device after you open the program. So what you got to do is close the program. Well, I'm going to check and see. Yeah. So I'm setting it. There's the speaker. All right. Set the levels. Check them. All right. Microphone. Yeah. Set the right one. Check the levels. All right. Yep. Set the sound card. Okay. Yes. Set the level. Checked everything. It was muted. All right. So... Still don't have it. Yeah, it's because the program needs to be restarted. So common error comes up. I left it in so you could see it. Okay, close the program. Start the program. Start Audacity back up. Come on, you can get it. There it is. Okay, they're both there. It's set. All right. Now we're recording. La 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 la. Hello, hello. That's too low.
Check. La 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 la.
That's too low. That's too quiet. Yeah, I'm faking this because I didn't record while I did that. So I'm doing it later. Okay, everything's set. All right. Got to turn up the input. Okay, did that. Let's try it again. La 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 la. Let's pretend that I'm actually saying what's going on here. It's a little more robust, but
la 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 la.
Not quite high enough. Okay. A little bit. La 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 la. Hey, 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 hey. That's a good level right there. About, you know, hit the space bar to play back. A little bit. La 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 la. Hey, 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 hey. That's a good level right there. About, you know. Levels are good. Let's get Davi on here on Skype and record. Go ahead and talk, sir. How are you today?
I'm doing pretty good.
No, you're doing well. Superman does good.
No, I'm doing good. I'm fine with my original statement.
You're helping the world. You're saving the kids.
Yep.
Cool, man. What's that feel like?
You know, it's kind of stressful, but it's fun. Helps me sleep at night.
Yeah, sleeping at night's good. I slept like a rock crossed with a baby on morphine last night, but not for long enough. I slept like 5 hours and had a plumber come over this morning. But I'm doing well. I'm doing good, too. I'm making this podcasting video, How to Podcast.
Cool, man.
All right. I'm going to stop recording. Hang on a sec. All right. Now I'm going to save the project, give it a descriptive name so it's easier to find later. Close the program, open it back up. You know, let's say this is later. Play it, see what it sounds like. Just play it.
Out by Harvard University on YouTube.
And
it's
fixing
about
it.
6 hours.
You're fixing it. All right, I go to normalize. Normalize to 0 decibels. There we go. It didn't do much normalizing because I recorded it at a good volume and at a consistent volume. But even so, it still helps to even everything out. Let's hit the space bar and play it.
Critiquing it. I'm pulling apart this professor's words. What's interesting is that about...
Hit the space bar to stop it. All right, method three, the one I like the best. Recording from Skype on one computer through a mixer with your mic plugged into the mixer and then recording out to an SD card recorder like a Zoom H2 or something else. All right, here we go.
All right, mixer set up, mic on stand, XLR three-prong output... into the mic. You got to push this little thing in when you pull these out. So there, it goes in like that. push this down, it comes out. Okay, push it in. It's on the mic. Mic's on the stand. Other end of the XLR cable is going into a channel of the mixer. This one doesn't have the thing you need to press. Just push this into there. It only fits one way. All right, got the input up. I would start with it about here, but I have it on here because I don't have any preamp on here. Compressor, you know, start around noon. Go up to there if you need. EQs, I generally start at noon. Noon is neither cut nor boost, but, you know, if you like it a little bit better, listen on the headphones when you're talking into it. Turn it up just a little bit. I tend to not like to add anything in the post-production. I like to do it in the while I'm recording so I don't have to fix it in the mix. You always want to get a good sound printing to disc or computer or SD card. Print to tape is what they call it. They used to call it, they still call it that, even though there's no tape anymore. So we have this all set up. I have my low cut button in, push down. That'll cut everything below the human voice. So it'll just cut the truck going by on the street or the cat jumping on the bed in the room. You know, low sounds. So yeah, I have the low cut switch in, pushed in, on, engaged. I always have my pan, left, right pan, straight up. So it's in both sides equally. It's pretty much what you want to do for almost any spoken material. Mute button should not be in. If it's lighting up and you can't hear yourself, it's because you accidentally stepped on it, pushed it, cat stepped on it, or you pushed it. Unmute it. Start with your fader, you know, around here, talk in the headphones, see if it's loud enough, bring it up if you need to. Look at the volume recording to Zoom H2 or whatever your device is, or to, you know, you can also record to Audacity on a computer. Put your headphones on, talk into the mic. You have your output to the speak to the headphones here. So try to get a good balance using this one and this one. And then, you know, other mics coming in, the Skype computer here. You have a Skype coming in from a computer onto, and I have mix minuses set up. That's a whole nother story, how to set those up. It's already been done. There's videos of it. I don't need to reinvent the wheel. I will link videos in the show notes and link my settings for my mixer on how to set up a mix minus. That's so you're not getting echo, you're not recording two iterations of your voice, and it's pretty easy to do, but you need to do it to set it up to get a good sound. All right.
And I record externally actually on a Zoom H2. You can get these on eBay, or there's a better Zoom out now. I'll link the better Zoom. They don't make this one anymore, but you can still find these on eBay. They're pretty reasonably priced, about $100, $150 bucks used. I record directly out of my mixer with a Y splitter, one side going to the headphones, the other side going to a 1/8 inch male-to-male plug. I'll link that in the show notes too. And that goes into the external mic in input on the right side. You want it in the mic in, not the line in. It just makes it sound better. It gives a little bit of onboard sound processing or something. I don't know. Part of the Fiend sound. I like it. I recommend it. I have the gain on this on low, and I have the volume setting on the left side. I have it set to, you have to press the menu button, then you change the incoming volume. I have it set at 80, 80. You know, that's also dependent on the mic gain on the right side being on low, or L of LMH. And a good volume to have it is to where your peaks are between halfway and two-thirds of the way up. Should be where the loudest of your talking ends up. And I press the little red button in the middle to start and stop recording. You have to hit it twice, once to arm it and then once to start it recording. When the numbers are going up, the time is going up, it's recording. And it'll automatically number them and put them in a folder. It'll start with 00 something, 001. You can set it to do whatever you want. Comes with a booklet, tells you how to set the folder. It's different for every device. A lot of this will work on any kind of hard disk, portable SD card, recorder, especially the Zoom model ones. They all kind of work the same. It's just a little bit different from each one. But oh, and don't pull out the SD card while this is on, or especially while it's still recording. You'll lose your file. I have it plugged into one switch on this
surge protector that turns everything off. So I make sure it's stopped and then turn everything off before I take out the SD card and then put it back in while everything's turned off before I turn it on. All these techniques would also work if you're recording in the same room with co-hosts rather than over Skype. You just each plug your mic into one channel of the mixer and get a good sound on the mixer with headphones or the headphone splitter. You might end up needing to get a 3 or 4 or 5 input headphone splitter if you have more than 2 hosts. Go to the settings, pick MP3. 96K, that's the best for talk. 64K, the default, is too low. 128K makes too big of a file to stream on chromed robot turds, cell phones, etc. Android phones, iPhones, fiend phones. Okay, I use 128K bitrate. That is a decision we've made only after moving to a dedicated server, which you probably won't be able to afford. We had to do it because we're getting massive amounts of downloads. And we went ahead and got one. So basically, it's not an issue and it downloads really quickly. And it should work for most people, although some people may still have problems over a chromed robot turd. But I think the bandwidth is getting so fast and available that I don't want to dumb down the audio quality to accommodate for it for the next year or so. It's going to catch up. But you might want to start out with 96K, see how it sounds. Then after you get really good, bump it up to 128K for future episodes. I also wouldn't recommend putting in ads until, or trying to get advertisers until you have a good following. It'll annoy people and you won't make much money at it at first. Same thing, don't put ads all over the website until you have a good following. All right, so save it as an MP3. You can also save it as a WAV and encode later in Lame Drop, like I show in my WordPress video. Or you can make the MP3 now. I think Lame Drop actually sounds a little better, but there's no technical reason why it should. They're using the same codec. I usually save it as a WAV first just to have it for the future. You know, maybe in case they come out with some much better file format than MP3 and some program that will instantly encode and tag, thousands of gigabytes of it. I save everything. I have a giant hard drive, 4 terabytes. All right, so let's play it. Here. Check, check. La la, la la, la la, la la.
Good.
Cool, man. Doing well. I'm doing good.
College course on ethics that's been put out by Peter's words.
Sounds good. You know, do a needle drop test, which is where you pick a few places across the file. I do that usually. Make sure there's no problems. All right. All right, here's a tip, too. If you're doing an interview that's longer than an hour, once an hour, or at least once an hour, every 45 minutes to an hour, disconnect from Skype. You don't need to close Skype. Just hang up. Say, hey, I'm going to hang up and reconnect you. Hang up on the person and call them back. Initially, right when you call back, it'll sound worse, but it'll immediately adjust and sound better. You'll get better audio over a longer timeline if you reconnect at least once an hour. Okay, mic technique. You want a mic that's on a stand, that's not attached to or on the table that's in front of you that you'll be touching, because otherwise you'll bump it and get mic sounds when you bump the table. So I have mine on a table next to me, clamped on to the table with a little bit of microphone foam under the clamp to deaden sound vibrations coming through the table and the mic stand. I have the mic on a stand in front of me with a windscreen. You want one of these, they cost about 50 cents each. I usually duct tape them down. I don't care how it looks. And mic technique is basically getting quieter, getting further away as you get louder and closer as you get quieter. Like if I'm getting intimate and quiet, I get right up on the mic. And if I'm back here saying all governments are immoral and corrupt, you know, I can lean off it and it kind of stays the same volume. I have a little bit of compression and I do the post-production normalization, but without leaning off the mic when I get loud and getting close up on it when I get quiet. I would have problems with levels. So you want the levels entirely consistent. You want no background noise. You don't want to have to fix it in the mix. You don't want to have to remove noise. You can do that in programs, but it kind of crunches the sound. You don't want to do that. You want to record with no noise. So you should be wearing headphones. You should be in a room that's somewhat sound conditioned. You can do that cheaper than even hanging up rugs like I did. You can nail up rugs. You can just hang blankets on, like curtain rods around you. Make a little sort of a booth. You don't need to be completely in a little hamster box, but you want to be, you don't want the reverberations off the wall. So it's pretty easy to make a room more studio-like without spending money or wrecking the room or doing major construction. Okay, show prep. Day or two before a show, I'll have a co-host send me some emails with ideas in them, and I keep them in a folder. I'll send them emails and keep a copy of it in a folder called Fiends Show Prep. Right before a show, I'll move them all into my inbox after clearing out my inbox like I do throughout the day. And it kind of helps to have stuff you can grab and just kind of do on the fly. We often have many show topics and only get to one of them and end up off on a tangent. It's kind of a more organic way to do a show, but it's really good to have some stuff to fall back to if you need to. I also keep a pad of paper and a pen next to me during a show, and I scribble stuff down as I think of it. Or if I'm telling a story, I'll write down if I go off on a tangent, I'll start with one thing, go off on a tangent and make a note to myself to come back and finish the story, because it's really unsatisfying to tell a story and not have it finished. People don't even know why they didn't like it, but there's something about it that wasn't quite right. So yeah, just kind of quick organizational stuff. It's kind of a no-brainer, but I've seen people not do anything like this and end up getting really, really lost in a show. All right, editing and advanced editing. Almost all of what I do in editing is scrolling the view of the timeline in the program in and out so I can see the macro view of it and then the micro view of it. And then trimming out little unneeded bits, not tons of them, just, you know, in an hour and a half show, maybe I'll trim out like 5 or 10 ums and ahs in long spaces. Just makes it a little snappier. Also putting in markers so I can go back to a certain place and know where it is. And then copying and pasting into longer files, putting in ads if I need it. Normalizing before I put in my ads or music, because the setting I use for normalizing talking is not good for normalizing music, and most of the music I use is already normalized. A lot of the commands are pretty much the same in all editing programs, mainly using Audacity here because it's free, but I normally use SoundForge. It's a little better on the normalization end, and I'm more used to it. It's a pay program, but I've been using it since it came out, so I'm used to it. You can use Adobe Audition. You can use any number of editing programs, whatever you're comfortable with. And a lot of the commands are going to be the same or very similar for scrolling and starting and stopping and putting in markers. All right, let's go.
In Audacity, to scroll, you hold down the control key with this thing, this hand, and then you scroll the mouse wheel, and it brings the view in and out. In SoundForge, you just scroll the mouse wheel.
And of course, the command to stop and start playback in SoundForge and Audacity and most audio and video editing programs is just hitting the space bar to stop and to start. Okay, putting in markers. It's Control B, as in boy, in Audacity. And you can type in a label there if you want. And in SoundForge, you just hit M. Okay, this next part is editing a whole episode. I do it really quickly. This segment, when I showed the rough cut of this to a bunch of friends, one of the comments several people said was that they didn't think I needed to show this whole editing section, but I've made a decision to leave it all in. If you're impatient, you can skip through and just watch part of this section. It's a lot of the same thing over and over, but I left the whole thing in to give a feeling of how I do it as a piece. The whole section's about 12 minutes. It's about what it takes for me to do the actual editing on a full-length episode. And then it takes me about another 20 minutes to do all the normalizing and coding, properly tag the MP3, write the show notes, upload. And, you know, so it takes me about, give or take, 30 minutes to go from finishing an episode till it's up on the Freedom Fiends website as, as a podcast ready to go out to the world. Took me longer when I started, but I've gotten better at it. All right, I'm going to take you through editing a whole Freedom Fiends episode. So I have the Zoom H2 SD card. I find the folder the stuff's in. I drag it to my desktop to copy it. I always copy and then delete the source. It's less likely to make problems than if I just cut and paste. I always copy and paste from one drive to another, then delete on the original drive if I need to. It may take longer than this depending on the power of your computer. Okay, so now I'm going to highlight and delete everything on the SD card from that folder. Take the SD card, put it back in the H2 or whatever your recording device is. Then I go to the Freedom Fiends site, find the last episode, copy the file name, file path, delete the MP3 part, copy just the file name, get rid of the file path, and then change, add one, you know, bring the file name up to the next one and change the date. Copy and cut that. Then open up my folder of files, change the name of the first one to the name of the next episode. And then open up my editing program. I'm using SoundForge. You can use Audacity. Drag them all in. Audacity works a little different when you bring a bunch of files in, but... Okay. Play it. Listen to it a little bit. Yep. Okay. Now I'm going to... I highlighted and deleted that first part. I hit the... Highlighted it. And then hit the delete key.
Space.
All right, do some needle drops, check around. I usually do the beginning and end of a file first. In this case, I'm not though. Okay, there's a space. I highlighted it.
Running.
Hit delete.
Post.
You know, you hold down your left mouse key to highlight it and drag it. And I'm just hitting the delete key to take out these spaces.
Recovery.
I don't take out all the spaces in an episode. Just take out...
All of the seven deadly sins...
You know, and I don't take out the whole space, just shorten the space.
You know, they suggest, you know, they say something like...
take that out.
They suggest, you know, they say something... They suggest, you know, they... So, they suggest, you know, they say something... So, they say something like...
That made me sound a lot smarter. And I just...
This has nothing to do with Quakers.
Take out that click.
I think somebody made a... Somebody, I don't know who, made an image of Ben... Being obsessed... Being obsessed... Off this... being obsessed... Off this Seven Deadly Sins...
I'm hitting the space bar to play, to stop and start play. Okay, I just visually look for... places where there's a long space.
Oh, this is the thing. AA has this, but yeah, so.
And
AA,
of course, I'm scrolling the view in and out.
But
I'll show you where I do that.
I don't even know where I was going with that. Oh, this is the thing.
Okay, save that. All right, find the next one. Do them in order. Get rid of that little space. Go to the end. Do the same thing.
So, on our record, loves. That was the.
Yeah, I'm scrolling the view.
Talk
right
about
there,
the
I just scrolled the view from the macro to the micro.
Okay. So go on.
But you know, I could see. I mean, think.
Again, I'm holding down the left mouse key and scrolling to highlight. Then I'm hitting the delete key on the keyboard.
I think so.
I really recommend SoundForge. I like version 8 better than version 9. It's kind of hard to find now, but you might be able to find it somewhere.
How governments... Because I think I want to call this up...
Oh, the fire is fake?
It may be...
It's fake?
Like I said, I don't go through the whole... Every little bit of the episode to do this, I just look for spaces and take them out. It makes the thing a lot snappier to listen to.
I guess mine was...
Go to the next one. Take out this space at the beginning. Go to the end.
Freedomfiends.com.
Didn't need one there.
He can't bribe every... That's impossible. So he can't bribe every troll living...
So sell me on this idea.
Save it.
You don't know who Vanessa Williams or Casey Kasem going. You know, to kill. I mean, I've heard.
Okay, save that. Go to the next one. Oh, there's a big space there.
Hand them out to
I think I left the recorder on during the break. I think that's what this is.
Look at the president's stone.
when we get back in hour two.
Yep. Okay, so then I just delete that hole where I think 5 minutes where I accidentally left it. Save it. Yes. Okay, next file. Okay, this one I'm adding a fade in because I started recording after the music was playing on this one by accident.
South Dakota.
Just deleting some of these spaces, shortening them up. You know, you can see them in the macro view here.
Interesting.
And then you go to the micro view and find them. Hold down the left mouse button and just hit the delete key. That's what I'm doing every time.
Over the past like 20 years.
Okay.
Could you whip that up pretty quick?
I don't know what the... Right?
Good question.
Like because...
Because he forgot to wear a flag pin one day.
Country exhibits those virtues, right?
Good question.
Like
delete. Take out that sniff. Like I said, just doing, you know, 10 or 20, 5 or 10 or 20 of these in an episode, these little edits.
It's a really touch.
It'll take like, you know, 30 seconds to a minute off the whole episode, but it just really makes it more snappy and listenable.
And, you know, and horn.
And yeah. So I looked it up on Wikipedia and it's.
Yeah. The other urban myth I've heard is I've definitely got each year. But okay. I could see a market for this if you could survive. I could see a market for this if you could.
Makes me sound smarter. Take out repeated stuff once in a while. I'll leave a lot of it in.
20 years ago, there was some guy. Yeah, and then doesn't he become a cop? Yeah, and then doesn't he become a cop?
Deleting that space at the beginning again.
Birds into your cerebellum.
But
another space, take it out.
Yeah, I.
This just all makes it better overall. Take another space out.
Thank you for your service.
For your service, sir.
Thank you for your service.
If you're not doing, we're talking about this little
quiet.
Now, see,
I don't take too many out, and I don't take all of it out. I leave a little bit in, so the phrasing can breathe naturally.
There are 10 people using that as an excuse.
There are
10 people using that.
This makes you sound smarter and less stupid.
Someone had just bought those.
Legitimately, not. It's only deeds can be punished.
Yeah, I did.
And of course, I'm not recording the commercials coming over GCN. I stop and start the Zoom H2 at the beginning of and end of each talk segment.
What happens?
You know, sometimes I'm busy doing a lot of things while I do it. That's why sometimes I.
That never happens.
That's why sometimes I end up starting it before or after the music starts. And I did some fixing of that here.
But you gotta have the ambition. You gotta go out and do it. You know, time.
But
right?
It's also true if you're
– Okay, I'm looking through. Looks pretty good. Yeah, there's
What's
one.
What's that takeoff on? It's a major human flaw is...
All right. Now I'm pasting them in there. I'm going from the last one to the first one, putting in markers as I go.
So that they are.
So that's
sometimes I'll take
so
another
cute.
Little one out as I'm doing this. Pretty. Hey, baby, can I see your Nula? Okay, there. Marker, hit M. Paste it all in. Save. Copy. Cut and copy. All right, go to the previous one. I'm going in order here. The file's getting longer as I do this. And when I get down to the one with the file name in it, which is the first one, it'll be the whole episode quickly and accurately edited. Marker, paste, save. It takes a little longer to save each time. Marker, paste, Control V to paste, save. All right, normalize. Use this setting in SoundForge. It's a great setting. It's better than the setting in Audacity, and I can't replicate this setting in Audacity. It's one of the main reasons I use SoundForge. It's just also I'm used to it, and it's easier to use. But it costs money. All right, there. It's normalizing. You can see the progress bar. Yeah. Boom. Now save it. That's your episode without the commercials. Okay. All right. Now I'm going to add in the commercials. So I highlight all my commercials. I don't use all of them all the time. Some of them are paid. Some of them are stuff I make. The paid ones I have to put in each time. But
I'd radio show.
Okay, just play it to see which one it is. These are already normalized. So this is I do this after the normalizing. Copy. Don't cut and copy. Just copy and paste. And I find where the marker is between sections and just paste it in.
ENPHONE.com.
Sometimes, you know, check the check to make sure it works okay. But I usually don't need to after doing it a long time. Grab the next one. Copy. Close. Paste. And I just keep doing this. I put one or two commercials, one or two 30 to 60 second commercials in. In each space. On radio, there's like 4 to 5 minutes of commercials in each space. It's unreal how many commercials are on radio.
Hey, this is Nathan Explosion from Death Clock.
It's actually the guy that does the voice of Death Clock. Brendan Small. We interviewed him. People think those are just sound alikes, but it's actually him. I like Death Clock.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like?
Creamy radio.
That's two ads in one place. In one file. Makes it easier.
Help keep it drone-proof.
Just go to these markers and find the place.
When you shop online.
Paste them in. SoundForge 9 has a problem where it moves the markers over as the file gets longer. SoundForge 8 does not.
Ross Ulbricht was arrested by the FBI in 2013 and charged with victimless crimes.
Copy. Paste. And the last one. Grab another one. See, I didn't use all of them.
You've heard of shinybadges.com. Are you tired of your taxes funding?
So I'm putting two in here. Picking the one I'm putting. Putting more than two. All right, there we go. There's three. Let's see what else there is. Yeah, won't use that one.
Love the fiends.
Maybe use it. Why not? Put a bunch in at the end. People have listened that far. They're going to listen anyway.
HONE.com.
And save the file. That's your podcast. Now you just have to make an MP3 of it. All right. Save that. delete the whole folder of everything that went into it. Open up your media folder, put it in, and there you go. And I usually would make an MP3 of it from there using Lame Drop. All right. I use this mixer. It is a Behringer Zenix series mixer. It's the Zenix X2442 USB. It's the big boy one. You don't need one this big, but I love the Zenix series. They're pretty quiet. They have some built-in effects if you need them. They have different buses if you need to have stuff coming to and from you, like dealing with the network. They have some built-in compression. They have a good preamp built in. You don't need an external preamp with them or external compression. And they can do a lot. Windows 8, you have to download a special driver from the Zenix site. If you get one and you plug it in and everything sounds horrible on it, you probably need a driver regardless of your system. Go to the Zenix site. Don't go anywhere else. Get the drivers from the Zenix site. You should get a mixer that has the sliders, because it's a lot easier to use the sliders while doing a live show to, you know, mute for coughs and things like that than it is with a round knob. Sliders are a lot more clean and easier to use, easier to grab, easier to bring back to where they were without making it sound like something just completely dropped out. Like if you're going to mute it to cough, or it's better than hitting a mute button and better than hitting a knob. It gives more of a linear, drops out naturally, comes back naturally, doesn't make it apparent like a mute button does with dropping any tiny, tiny bit of background room noise. This one also has a bit of compression. If you have a good mic connected by XLR, you can't use USB in with a mic into this mixer, but you do have USB out to the computer. But I actually use a balanced line, quarter inch out, to and from my Skype computer and to and from my Comrex, which goes to and from the network. But if you're not doing a network show, you don't need a Comrex. And hopefully pretty soon we'll have Fiend Phone, which will be better than Skype, so you won't need Skype anymore. Go to fiendphone.com to donate. This compression will work pretty well. I was using this external rack mount compression tube preamp, but found out I don't really need it. It was kind of overkill. This cost about $300. I've really developed good enough mic technique to not need it. And if you have a little bit of mic technique and a good mic and it's on a stand near your face and you don't have a lot of background noise in your room and you put on a little bit of compression, like turn this compression up to like, 3 o'clock, you'll probably be okay and not need any external processing. And if you get a smaller mixer, whether it's a Behringer Zenix or not, sometimes the smaller ones overheat and they will shut off after 45 minutes or an hour and will eventually die from overheating. It's really easy to fix. You just put blocks of wood or blocks of like tackle boxes like this, something to lift it up and get a little airflow underneath the mixer. All right, that's most of what I know. And let's see. I monitor out through a headphone splitter. One side goes to the Zoom H2 to record on SD card. The other side goes to my headphones through this little volume control. Looks like a little kidney bean. These are like $6. I'll list this too. It's pretty useful because it doesn't affect the level going to the Zoom H2. It just affects the level going to the headphones. You turn it up and down without affecting the recording volume. And let's see, when I'm all done, I just turn everything off with this and I swing the mic up and out of the way with my scissor stand until I need to do a show again. And then cover the mixer up with the homemade Catmaster 300. I'll link the instructions to make that. Keeps the cats from pressing buttons. When they press buttons, it can be very frustrating when you don't know it and try to go do a show. And then when I'm done, I just cover everything up and tuck a clean towel around it to keep the cats away and keep everything safe and dust-free. That's it. In summation, a couple things I didn't add. Don't call your podcast daily, weekly, or after dark. You don't want to lock yourself into a format that you might want to change later. Keep the windscreens away from cats. They will play with them and chew on them and eat them up and destroy them. Vacuum weekly, both your workspace and the inside of your computers, and blow them out with some canned air. You don't want to live in filth and your computers will die. Dust will eat them. I can't stress that enough. Don't do high memory stuff with your computer while you're recording, editing, or encoding. You can while uploading, but you know. Don't blow smoke or vapes on your mic. It's not good for them.
And if you found this video helpful, please tell two friends and make a donation. There are links in the show notes below. If you did not like this video, go make your own damn podcasting tutorial. Thank you. That's the end of my tutorial. Hope it was helpful. And go to freedomfiends.com. There's some links below where I'm posting this video. And there's also, if you want to donate Bitcoin or PayPal, that's helpful too. Send it around. I want more liberty people doing media. And tell two friends. And thank you for your service. Worms. Yeah.